I'm Sin with the OSINT Dojo. In this video, we're going to discuss different ways of leveraging Shodan in order to locate servers that host websites on the dark web. I'm going to cover a few different ways of doing this, starting with the simplest techniques first, and then working our way up to the more advanced ways of searching. For this demo, I am using an account with Shodan membership, so keep that in mind. If you do have a free account, it may differ both in its results as well as its capabilities. As we go through each of these techniques, also keep in mind that the results shown in Shodan will depend heavily on the configuration of your target website, with some targets not returning any results, even if you use a combination of these techniques. Now, we're going to use this Bitcoin Explorer website in order to demonstrate all of these different techniques. If you'd like to follow along, I've dropped the website's URL into the description below. And so, by far the absolute most simple way that you can identify some of these servers is by simply querying a .onion URL within Shodan. As you can see here, we do have one result for the URL of our target website. If we click on this result, we can see the reason that we have this one result is because our URL is found here in the header under the .onion location attribute. Now, of course, in order for this to work, you would need to already know the full URL of your target website. But what if you just wanted to see how many servers had this specific attribute in their headers? We can also do a simple search for onion location and see that as of the time of this recording, there are nearly 1,000 results. Another way to search for servers hosting websites on the dark web is by searching by their favicon, which is this little image up here in the corner of our browser tab. Now, we can't just drop the raw photo like in Google Images. Instead, we're going to need to get the hash of this favicon. So, we're going to copy the URL for this image and move over to this website here, favicon-hash.com. If you're a fan of running the favicon through an online tool, there's also other ways you can get the hash value of the image, such as writing a quick Python script as well. So we're going to paste in the URL to our favicon and click calculate here. You'll notice that we're getting an error. Well, this is because our favicon exists on the dark web. This tool, which is on the clearnet, has no way of actually reaching out to the .onion site and grabbing our favicon image. So what we can do instead is just upload the favicon to our public GitHub repository and then use that direct URL instead. As you can see, this gives us a result which we're going to then copy over into Shodan, but make sure that you don't forget the minus sign here if your hash happens to include one. We're just going to paste that into our favicon search query, which includes http://favicon.hash:, and then our calculated hash value without any spaces in between. What this is going to do is it's going to look for devices that Shodan has indexed that include the same favicon as our target. As you can see by our results here, we do have the original result that we saw previously, but there's also a second result here based out of China that we haven't seen before. And finally, the website is not searchable simply by using the .onion URL or by the favicon. We can also do queries based on the combination of unique attributes within the response and request headers. These are going to vary from website to website, but the idea here is to add in different combinations to try and narrow down the results being few enough for us to sort through. In order to view these headers, we're going to open up the developer tools in our browser and select network. Next, we're just going to reload the page and wait for the results to appear. Clicking on the first result, we can see that the headers have different parameters included. We're just going to start copying and pasting these into Shodan to see how many results appear. So searching for the cache control gives us 465,000 results. This is way too common of an attribute to narrow down to our individual target. So let's go back and copy the expires information and try pasting that in as well. This narrows it down significantly. We only have 76 results now. This might be doable, but let's see if we can narrow it down a little bit further. So down here further, we have the if modified since parameter. Now Shodan search syntax actually calls it something different. So we're going to change that to last modified and then search using that parameter. And now, unfortunately, we don't have any results, which is a bit odd since we know we located the server using the previous two methods. So let's take out one of our parameters here. Let's remove the expire timestamp and let's do the search again. And sure enough, now we have 17 results, of which include the original target that we were looking for. Let's open up this result and take a look at what content Shodan captured and see if we can determine exactly why we had no results when we included all three parameters. As you can see here, the expire timestamp is actually different on the data Shodan captured versus what we saw in our headers, which makes sense considering that the timestamp when Shodan captured this data was likely from a time prior to when we just ran our original queries. though if we go back and check the other parameters that we searched off of, we can see that they do indeed match. This is something you want to keep in mind, as my advice here is to always play around with the different parameters to see which ones work best for you, as each target and each use case is going to differ.